First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation. And the topic of my presentation is modal identification and modal updating of the Metsovo Bridge. So it's two things that I'm going to be talking about. First, I will show the Bayesian uncertainty quantification framework, which we used to perform the modal updating. So we took that approach, the Bayesian approach. Then I will show the Bayesian tools and challenges, computational challenges we faced and how we overcame them. And then show the application for the case of the Metsovo Bridge with actual measurements and model updating. We have this one. The red one. Okay, thank you. So we have our computational system, which we denote by the letter M, which in our case is a finite element model, which is parameterized by the parameters theta. And these parameters can be anything that can be parameterized through the finite element program. It can be something related to the modulus of elasticity or some other material property or some spring constant, or whatever can be parameterized by the finite element program of choice. And this model predicts some output quantities of interest, which in our case, it's going to be mode shapes and modal frequencies. And because our model is linear, we know that the linear equations of motion can reduce to the very well-known Eigen problem, where we note that the matrices K and M, the stiffness and mass matrices, depend on the parameters theta. So if we change these parameters, we also change the system matrices, and the results of the Eigen problem, which are the natural frequencies and the mode shapes, also change. So we have a parameterized finite element model up to this point. Next, we have the real system from which we get observations, which can be response time histories, nonlinear frequency response functions, but in our case, we use modal frequencies and mode shapes, experimentally identified modal properties. And we use Bayesian inference to perform parameter estimation, and model selection can also be done. Now I will show you the case of parameter estimation, which is essentially the model updating procedure. We are going to update our knowledge about the parameters theta through actual data of the structure. And we are also going to quantify their uncertainties, because we will see that there is a range of values that these parameters can take, each one with a different associated probability. I will not spend much time in the theoretical formulation. I'm just going to draw your attention to the likelihood function, which is the most important part in the Bayesian formulation, which is the probability. With D, we denote the data. The data, as I said before, in our case, is mode shapes and modal frequencies, experimentally identified through measurements, through acceleration measurements. And the likelihood function is the probability of getting the data given a specific value of the parameters, theta, and of course our model. To formulate the likelihood, we first need to establish a probabilistic model between the measurements and the model predictions, which in the simplest case can take this form. We say that the measured data is the model predicted data plus some error term, which we assume to be normally distributed, and we split into two parts, the experimental error and the model error. We split into two parts because the experimental error, we can have an estimate of it from the measurements. So the only unknown parameters here are in the variance of the model error. That's why we include these parameters in theta. And after we formulate the likelihood, the reason that we do that is because for parameter estimation, the important function is the posterior PDF, which is related and it's dominated by the likelihood, actually. For a large number of data, this can be proven. I will not get into details about the other probabilities because this is not a Bayesian presentation. I'm just going to say that the posterior PDF is the important function here, which is represents our updated state of knowledge about the parameters theta given the data. This is the important thing here. The prior is what we know about the parameters theta before getting the data, and we update it to the posterior PDF after we have obtained the data D. The next equations can be used for model selection, which we are going to see a case. And also an important part is the predictions that this model makes. So since the parameters are uncertain, the predictions are also uncertain. And these equations here, in a real situation, cannot be evaluated analytically. If our model is a finite element model, we only know the values of the model at specific points. We don't have an analytical formula for them. So we will see what tools we use to get actual results from this. The Bayesian tools are mainly asymptotic approximations and sampling methods. Here we use the sampling method, specifically the MCMC method, which require a moderate to very large number of model reanalysis. So we have to analyze our model again and again for different values of the parameters. And this introduces these computational challenges because our model, as we see, is actually quite complex and has a very large number of degrees of freedom. And this results in excessive computational effort. So to face these problems, we employ the following techniques at the level of the algorithm and the level of the model. At the level of the algorithm, we use the parallel version of the MCMC of the Markov chain Monte Carlo, which is called the transitional Markov chain Monte Carlo, which can run in many CPUs simultaneously in more than one computer and achieve greater performance and reduced times. And we also employed surrogate models. Surrogate models just reduce furthermore the number of model runs because we only evaluate the model at some specific parameters, and then the surrogate model can be used to interpolate in an intelligent way to evaluate the model at intermediate values without having to calculate the whole model again. So this reduces the number of full model runs. And at the model level, we applied the model reduction technique component mode synthesis, which we will see in the next slides, that what it does, it essentially reduces the size of the matrices of the problem. So if we have 500,000 degrees of freedom, we know that the stiffness and mass matrices will be square matrices of 500,000 dimension. And using the CMS technique, we can reduce it by 3 orders of magnitude, as we will see. And let's move to the application, to the Metsova bridge, where, as I said, we used modal frequencies and mode shapes as data. We did parameter estimation using the Bayesian framework. Our model is finite element model, linear, but with a large number of degrees of freedom. And we use the techniques that I showed earlier, because otherwise the computational effort takes months to compute. Here we see a picture of the Metsova bridge and some characteristic dimensions. And here we see that the finite element model is built from solid elements, quadratic Lagrange elements, and it's 560,000 degrees of freedom. And using the CMS technique that I showed earlier, the basic equation here is the last one, which actually says that if we want to evaluate the system matrix, the stiffness matrix, for a different value of the parameters theta, because as I said, parameters theta formulate the model, they can be material properties, so if we change them, the model changes. We do not have to reassemble the stiffness and mass matrices again to perform the whole finite element formulation to get the large matrices and solve the large Hankean problem, but we can use this linear expansion, and the matrices involved in these expansions are found just once by the method. And then we just use the expansion at different values of the parameter theta and get the reduced system matrix. And this matrix has a reduced dimension. In this case, from nearly 500,000 degrees of freedom, the reduced model and thus the reduced stiffness and mass matrices have just 400 degrees of freedom. So we do not have to reassemble the finite element method formulation again. And obviously, the eigenproblem takes much less to solve because the matrices are three orders of magnitude smaller. And we get a less than 0.1% errors in the model frequency estimates for the first 20 modes. And now we move to the model identification part, where we used 5 triaxial and 3 uniaxial sensors to cover the entire length of the bridge. The software used is developed in the University of Thessaly System Dynamics Laboratory. And we measured acceleration time histories under normal operating conditions. That is, the excitation was traffic and environmental excitation, such as wind loading. So it was done in a real time operation of the bridge. We covered the entire length in 13 sensor configurations, where we see in these pictures, the left picture shows the reference sensors with the green dots. The reference sensors stayed there for the entire procedure because we need to have common sensors among different setups, because we will see why in the next slide. And the moving sensor, which are the blue ones, we see one specific configuration here, moved from each point to the next in order to cover the entire length of the bridge. The data acquisition was 20 minutes and 10 minutes break to move the sensors. And to establish the synchronization in order for them to start measuring simultaneously, this was ensured by GPS in each one of the sensors. And now for the location of the reference sensor, it is important because you want to avoid having sensors in points where the mode shape has a node that is zero displacement, because otherwise you will not get the mode shape there. And specifically for reference sensors, that's a very bad thing to have. So an optimal sensor location methodology was done prior going to the actual field measurements, which is based on the principle of maximum entropy, in order to find which are the optimal locations for the reference sensors. And you see the results here, the red vertical lines are the solutions, where it's quite intuitive, actually, because you see that they are in the places where most mode shapes have a large value. And so we placed our reference sensors at that point. But because this methodology depends on the finite element model, and always the finite element model can be somehow not so accurate, we used another reference sensor just to be safe. And the moving sensors moved for 20 meters at its step to cover the entire length of the bridge. So another aspect of the experimental model identification is, OK, you measure 13 configurations, you get the local mode shapes in each one of them, but how do you get the global mode shape? That's not trivial to do, because once you measure in these 5 or 6 points, you get the local mode shapes, but only at these degrees of freedom. But we're not interested in only this. We're interested in the entire length of the bridge. So this problem is called mode shape assembly. And the procedure followed by the program is proposed by AU in 2010. And it's based on a least squares fit of the local mode shapes to the unknown full mode shape. And that way, we get the full mode shape by assembling its configuration, all the configurations. And we see some representative results here, where the top images are the model predicted, the finite element model predicted mode shapes. And below, we see the experimentally identified, obviously after the mode shape assembly has taken place. And we see a quite good fit, even before the model updating. And we see the results of the model updating. By the results, I mean the fits of the predicted frequencies and mode shapes, where the mode shapes being vectors are compared through their Mach value. And the differences are very small because, as I told you, the model was already good enough. But if you look at the numbers, there is an improvement. Even though the model was provided a good fit from the beginning, there is still an improvement from the model updating. That is, the parameters were found to have better values and produce a better fit with the data. And so this is the model updating part. And I will show you another application, which is in the axial load estimation of hangers of arch bridges, where we used modal frequencies again as data. And then there the problem was to estimate the axial load, because here we see the axial bridge, the arch bridge, which has hangers, and we measured a couple of them. I show you one here. We have a finite element model of the beam, which is quite detailed because the support is kind of weird. And our goal there is to estimate the axial load to see if this is in the normal operating range of the hanger. And to do that, here we did the model selection technique. So we had five different models, three in finite element formulation in Abacus, and two simple models. So we had a model selection problem, which we faced again through the Bayesian model selection framework to decide which of the models is the best. The models differ with respect to their parameters, and the parameters modeling the boundary conditions. So first we have fixed ends, then we added some spring constants, then even more spring constants, and the same in the analytical model, which is the equations of the beam, nothing to do with finite elements. What we see here is the result of the Bayesian model selection, which is the evidence for each of the models. And to put it simply, the evidence means that the higher evidence means the better model. And it's interesting to note here that the model with the fixed ends has the worst evidence, which means that the support is not fixed at all. There is displacement there, which must be taken into account. And another important thing is that the model with the more parameters is not better from the one with the four parameters. It gives a smaller evidence. That is because even by introducing more parameters, the data, the does not get significantly better. So introducing parameters for no good reason is bad, according to the Bayesian model selection theory. And here we see the axial load estimation from each of the model, which we see that except from the first model with fixed ends, the other models kind of agree to a 1.1 times a nominal value, which a nominal value is just an initial guess we did based on the design assumptions of the hangers. And these are the results for the Bayesian model selection, where we concluded that the model B is the best. So there is no point in introducing more parameters because they don't do anything better. And that way, model selection shows us the second model with the four parameters. And that concludes also the Bayesian model selection part of my presentation. And we saw how CMS techniques can reduce the computational burden of our model. The parallel implementation of the Markov chain Monte Carlo was used to draw samples from the posterior PDF in order to represent it, to find where the parameters are located in the support domain. And we also use surrogate models to further reduce the time to manageable levels. And with that, I would like to thank you. That's my presentation.